Okay, this should now be recording both the screen and the audio. First thing we want to do is see if you guys know what mysticism is. And the truth is, of course, there's no correct or incorrect answer. It's one of those words, like magic and even religion, that have different meanings to different people in different times, different religions, et cetera, et cetera. And scholars disagree among themselves. In other words, it's a complicated idea, and we need to try to approach it with clarity and understanding the different conceptualizations of it, even if we may agree with one and disagree with another. So, who wants to go first and define what they think mysticism is? Because you may be coming here with a misconception, right, of what this class is going to be like. I'll tell you how I'm going to approach it in just a minute. Anybody want to give us the first guess or opinion? Yes?
Isn't it like a focus, a religious focus on the inward self, and which often, like, you're supposed to be attaining some secret level or some sacred level of holiness within yourself as an individual, and there's lots of often rituals or languages associated with it.
Those are all characteristics of mysticism, but the mystics themselves would probably say it's a focus on God, transcending yourself. But that's right. It is an inward spiritual phenomenon, an inner rather, not inward. Yeah?
Quest for religious knowledge, not through theology or organization, but through individual experiences.
Okay, that's often a definition. It is the search for knowledge of God through direct experience. So you don't talk about God, you experience God. That's something that a lot of mystics would define. Yes?
Now, when I hear mysticism and esotericism, I think of ideas rather than organizations. I don't know if that...
That's often the case. There are mystical beliefs, movements, practices that are attached to or beside religion. So there's Catholicism and there's mystical Catholicism. There's Islam and mystical Islam. So, there is no religion mysticism. It is a type of religious belief and behavior that you find in many, if not most, major religions.
I'm thinking of the Shroud of Turin, for example. That could appeal to not just Catholics, but to Protestants.
Yeah, that would be more, the Shroud of Turin would be an esoteric thing that might be mystically approached and mystically interpreted by mystically inclined Catholics. I was in Rome this summer, and I went to the Santa Croce in Gerusalemme, which is the Holy Cross in Jerusalem Church dedicated to Helena, and they have in there a copy of the Shroud of Turin. And I went in there, was looking at it, and there was a Catholic guy praying towards a crucifix. And he got mad at me. He said, "Why do you come in here and look at the Shroud of Turin? Why aren't you praying to God?" So he was upset that I was, poking my nose around instead of approaching it spiritually. That's a difference between a mystical approach to that thing and me kind of just, anthropologist looking at the natives type of thing. And we'll talk about imic versus etic approaches to these questions a little bit later. That's another concept. Who else wants to poke up? Nobody? Come on. Everybody has to make a comment or you'll fail the course. Yes? Okay. It is about, in many ways, mysticism is a highly charged emotional interconnection with God, but there's also very strong intellectual components, and in fact, the mystics wouldn't necessarily distinguish between the two like we might. Okay? Okay, that's important. There's a lot of ways that mystical worldviews differ from modern materialistic empiricist worldviews, and we'll be discussing these throughout the semester. Okay, that gives you a sense of different perspectives on what mysticism is. The first reading for next time is approaching a couple of the scholars whose books we have. We'll discuss those in just a second, and how they define mysticism. But let's quickly now go through the syllabus, and let me explain what's going on here. We have a blog or a web page for this class. It is linked at hamblinhistory485.wordpress.com. On there is everything that I put on the board here is going to be accessible, like these notes and bibliographies and syllabi and stuff. They're all accessible there. You need to go to that web page, and if you've registered for the course, I have sent you an email telling you to follow it. But you go to this web page, and then you click follow. So if you open this, here's the web page, and it has on it a bunch of entries. Like this is notes for topic 3, which we'll be discussing. Let's see, it's going to be Monday, I guess. Okay? So they are up there, and they're basically just an outline of ideas that we're going to be discussing. This is notes for Friday, which is this what is mysticism that we kind of started talking about here. Then there's a reference bibliography. Then there are readings. So a lot of the readings come from the books, which we'll discuss in a second, but there might be some additional readings. These are short little two-page essay type things. And then there's the syllabus and schedule. So what we're looking at now, the syllabus and schedule is online at that web page. So you need to go to that web page. You can download all this stuff, and then you have to click follow. You see follow there? It'll say follow, meaning if you haven't followed yet. It'll show you a check with following if you have, and then you can unfollow by just clicking there. And what happens when you follow is that it will send you a email every time I post something there. Might be notes, might be an announcement, might be an assignment, whatever. I'll post it there. If you are following, you will get that sent to you. Okay?
I tried to follow earlier, and there wasn't a button that I could find anywhere that said follow. And I checked on here on my phone as well, and I don't see it there either.
Yes?
I just followed it a couple hours ago, and it was at the bottom right corner.
That could be where it was. Okay. Yeah, I did check there.
It may be somewhere else than it is on my particular thing. I don't know. Look around for it. If there's still problems, let me know. But try to find it in other places then. Anything else? Okay, so what we're discussing is the syllabus and the schedule, and you just click here and can download both of those when you want to use them. Okay? So, first of all, the class is about mysticism and esotericism. And we will be defining those terms in the course of the next few days. But basically, mysticism is like we were describing here. It is an attempt to have a direct experience with God, as opposed to being told by a priest or a book what God is. You have a direct encounter with God. Esotericism is about secret or hidden or knowledge about sacred things. All right? These are overlapping but not coterminous. That is, lots of mysticism is esoteric, but not all esotericism is mystical. Does that make sense? So we're focusing on kind of the confluence of the mystical and the esoteric. But esoteric, we'll define these terms or discuss these terms in greater detail later, but that's kind of what it is. Now, the course is organized it is a senior seminar, so it has a lot of reading and a lot of writing. You'll have to write papers, you'll have to write short essays that, you know, give you a week to write a one-page essay on some topic or other. Some of these you'll pick, some of these I'll assign. So there's a strong writing component and lots of reading involved in the course as well. All right? Questions on that? Now, we're going to be looking at four different traditions. We're mainly focusing on the Middle East because that's my expertise, but will these extend into Europe as well? So the Hellenistic, meaning the time of from Alexander the Great to the fall of the Roman Empire, the pagan culture of that time, philosophical, Gnostic, Hermetic, etc., etc. Then we'll look at Jewish, Christian, and Muslim mysticism, which share some antecedents with the previous Hellenistic stuff. But there are many other mystical traditions, Hindu, Buddhist, Taoist, Native American. I mean, there's a whole bunch. So we're, because this is my area of expertise, we're focusing on what I can talk coherently about. Okay? And we do a lot of reading in primary sources from these different traditions. We have, I think, four primary reading, no, maybe just three primary reading books. Okay? Now, my contact information is best to reach me by email. There's my office. There's my phone, office hours and stuff. So, you know, my contact information is there on the blog. Now we need to look at the texts. There's a bunch of books for this class. And I apologize for the readings, but in fact, reading is the best way to learn. So that's what we're doing. The first one is... Goodrich Clark. This is a book that is largely about Western, what's called Western esotericism, which means Western European. And it's largely about the Renaissance to the present. So it really falls outside of what I'm focusing on, which is ancient medieval stuff. So this kind of fills the gap of what's going on after my area of expertise. So we're not going to go into this in as much detail as we do some of the other things, but, you know, it provides a broader context for a lot of ideas. Okay, and this is a kind of a textbook. It is not a primary source reader. Okay, so that's Goodrich Clark. The next one is McGinn. This is Christian mysticism. McGinn is probably the greatest scholar of Christian mysticism around today. And this book is a selection of primary sources across many different traditions, that is, Christian traditions, you know, Protestant, Catholic, et cetera, and Orthodox. And it is arranged thematically. Now, there are advantages and disadvantages with a thematic arrangement. The advantage is you can see how ideas, you know, are the significance of ideas across a long period of time. The disadvantage is you kind of lose the historical context. So it, you know, has advantages and disadvantages. That's McGinn. And basically we spend 1/4 of the class on McGinn, 1/4 of the class on the Jewish, and 1/4 of the class on the Muslim, and then 1/4 of the class on the pagan. So the next book is Salmon. This is the Corpus Hermeticorum, it's called. It's a group of Hellenistic mystical texts, and we'll discuss this in detail. This is kind of a New Age translation, but it's cheap. More scholarly translations like $70 or something, so I chose this one too. I like the other translation better, but this will give you the basics of it. What's the next one? Schaefer. Schaefer's book is a historical textbook about Jewish mysticism. Up through maybe the 6th or 7th century AD. It doesn't get into the later Kabbalistic stuff. But it's good, and since Christian and Islamic mysticism derive out of the Jewish mysticism of these periods, or at least they're interconnected together, this gives us a good foundation of the background of how all these things develop. Then the next one is Sells, which is this book, and this is a primary text collection on Muslim mystics, and it is ordered by mystic chronologically as opposed to thematically. So you know, there's different approaches by these different authors to their topics. And then the last book is Untermann, and that's this Kabbalistic tradition, and this is basically an anthology of Jewish mystical texts, again ordered thematically. So basically what we're going to do in this class is spend half of the period discussing a historical contextual issue, and then half of each period discussing some of these primary texts that we read. So for each period, there'll be a kind of an academic approach and then a primary text approach to try to understand what these guys are saying. All right? And sometimes it's pretty hard to understand what they're talking about because, you know, they have their own way of viewing the universe, which is often radically different than ours. Okay, so that's more or less how we're going to approach the class. What that means is, from your perspective, is number one, you have to read the material before you come to class, because we'll be discussing the material. If you haven't read it, you're not going to understand the discussion. This material is difficult, and I understand that you may not get it all, and that's fine. We will discuss in class some of the ideas that, you know, major ideas that are in there. So it's not easy reading material. The next thing you'll have to do is probably I'll assign you to maybe take 5 minutes and talk about one of the texts, you know, one of these primary texts. We'll take turns letting you guys kind of lead a discussion. That'll force you to kind of go into more depth and try and understand it and stuff. And then another thing we'll do occasionally is have you write little essays, like a response essay to a particular mystic or mystical text or theme. Okay? But it's a fair amount of reading, and it's often difficult. All of these books have good introductions introducing the ideas by the editors, right? So, I mean, it kind of sets the framework for what's going on here. Okay, questions on that? You need to read through the essay or the syllabus on your own to get more information here. But basically, we'll have occasional quizzes, and these don't necessarily mean quizzes. These might be, I'll just say, okay, take 5 minutes and write down a major idea you found from this reading. So it's not necessarily going to be, you know, A, B, C, D, but it will be some type of, right at the beginning of class, some type of response to the reading for the day. There'll be a number of short essays, and these will be, like, I'll give you a week to do them. You just write a one-page thing. I'll say, okay, we're gonna read about Halaj here in the Islamic mystics. I want you to write a one-page essay of what you think about Halaj. And this is not an emotive response, but an analytical critique of what his ideas are, what he thinks, you know, and maybe how it relates to some of the other things. Then we'll have a major paper, which is a research paper that you get to pick the topic for, and we'll discuss the details of that later, and then a couple of exams, which will probably be largely essays, maybe a few short answers and fill in the blanks, that type of thing. Okay? Questions on that? Now, we have the paper, which is basically a research paper that you can pick any topic you want on mysticism. You can do, say, Taoism if you want, but, you know, we will discuss Eastern mysticism a little bit at the end and modern mystical and esoteric movements a little bit at the end, but our focus is on ancient medieval Europe and Middle East, because, as I said, that's what I've spent my time studying. You can go beyond that if you want to for your paper. And basically, it could be anything you want. It could be a mystic, a mystical idea, a mystical movement. Like within Sufism, there are what are called tariqa, which means paths or ways or roads, and these are Sufi movements. They're still around today. And that's an interesting thing, is that Jewish, Christian, and Muslim mysticism is still living phenomenon today. The pagan mysticism disappeared, but has been revived in what you could call neo-pagan movements from the late 19th century on. And how much they relate to their ancient antecedents can be debated, but they claim to be, you know, the revivals of, say, Hermetic thought in pagan Egypt and things like that. Okay? So, it's composed of a number of elements that you first pick a topic. basically, you could pick a topic that you want, but you have to be able to use primary sources on it. Now, some sources, some topics have lots of primary sources available, some not so much, and you have to pick one that you can deal with primary sources. I assume most of you can't do Hebrew and Greek and Arabic and Latin and so forth. So I assume you're going to need to use English primary sources. But maybe you went on a mission to France. If you can find some stuff about French stuff, great. If you can read German, great. If you can read Arabic from the Mesa major, that's fine. You could, you know, go try to read Sufi material in Arabic. It is a real, it's hard enough to understand in English, let alone trying to read in Arabic. But, you know. So, you pick your topic. Then once I approve that, and we might negotiate. Like you say, I want to do a particular Muslim mystic, and I'll say, well, you know, Jalal ad-Din Rumi, there's a lot more material on him, and it's been translated in English, and there's more than, you know, some other mystic. So I may just say, okay, you want to do a Muslim mystic, this one you're going to have better luck with because it's, you know, lots of translations. And there is a problem with mystical primary sources in that a lot of them are New Age translations, which are often quite free and have nothing to do with what they're supposedly translating. So, you know, we got to deal with that as well. Then you do a research bibliography, which is includes both primary and secondary sources. Ensure that you've got the primary sources to your paper. Then you do an outline. And at all these levels, I will be consulting with you and responding to whatever you hand in to me, and then the final research paper. Okay? So that's more or less the course requirements. Any questions or issues on those? Is that clear to everybody? And again, all of this stuff should be available to you on the web. So, what's going on? Dang it. All right, we'll just try to press ahead here. I've got the pinwheel of death here. I always hate the pinwheel. Let's look at the schedule here, and yeah, okay. Why did I get the spinning pinwheel of death? Okay, we need to look at the schedule just briefly so I can explain to you how it's organized, and what you're supposed to do with this. This again is up on the web. So basically what you've got is several columns here. This is the day of the week, Monday, Wednesday, Friday. This is the date. So this is, you know, 3rd September, 5th September, and so forth. This is the topic number. And what we'll be discussing, oh, this is my 240 class. Never mind. Oh, I got the wrong one. Can you move through that? Sorry, folks. Don't know why it crashed there. All right, that's it. And then we have what we're discussing. So today is the introduction to the course. Next time we'll be discussing mysticism and esotericism. And then the last column shows you what the reading is for that day. And it's based basically on the last name of the book. And then it gives you the pages. And this is a chapter, so Goodrich Clark, chapter 1, chapter 2. So we kind of start with Goodrich Clark. And then as you'll see, basically we go through, first we do Goodrich Clark, then we do Schaefer and Unterman, then we do McGinn, then we do Sells. So you know, you should bring that book to class, at least the primary source books, because we will, you know, be reading through them and talking about them, and then you'll need to have that text with you. So you don't need to bring all the books every time, but whatever one we're discussing for that period, you should bring to class. Okay? So you've got then this, you know, this next time we're doing mysticism and esotericism, then we're doing the origins of it, then mystery religions, and these are all pagan phenomenon that essentially get picked up in various ways into Christianity, Judaism, and Islam, and transformed and become part of later Christian, Jewish, and Muslim mysticism. Now, when I say monotheistic mysticism, I mean Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. I combine all three into monotheistic. Even though you could maybe argue, well, maybe Buddhism's kind of monotheistic, and there are Advaita forms of Hinduism that are kind of monotheistic. But when I use that term, monotheistic or Middle Eastern monotheisms, I mean Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. Although technically it's probably a broader idea. Okay? So the readings, the topics, and then this in bold black is when the different parts of the paper assignments are due. So next Monday, a week from Monday, we need the research paper topic. And then a little bit later, bibliography for that research paper. And you know, we can discuss each of your research ideas individually. And again, it can be anything you want to do as long as it's related to some form of esotericism or mysticism. Okay? Any questions? Oh, we've got the exams here listed in kind of shaded gray and stuff. Okay? Any questions on any of that? Yes?
So are the reading quizzes just randomly assigned?
Yes. I will, like, you know, after you read this, next time I may come in and say, okay, write for 5 minutes, tell me what you think mysticism is. See if you've changed your mind after reading these guys. See what I mean? Or I may just have a little quick five-thing question, like, you know, I will say, does McGinn use the term experience or presence to define mysticism? And if you look at this book, he'll discuss that in the first, his introductory, where he's defining mysticism. And then you'll have to pick which one he uses. You see what I mean? Something like that. Basically, it's to compel you or encourage you to do the readings. Okay, any questions on any of that? Then I think, what's my next? Whoops. Okay, we talked about syllabus, textbook schedules. Did I show you the webpage? Or did I just talk about it? I showed it to you, right? Okay, so you've seen that. There's a reference bibliography then, and we need to look at that. Basically, what I've done here is put online, or a list here, which I've posted on the blog, of the major reference works associated with these different cultures. And I have done a little abbreviation of when I cite these, like, you know, I may put a reference to something. These are the abbreviations I'll use, which are standard academic abbreviations. So let me just briefly explain what each of these books are. We should have them all in our library. This is the Dictionary of Gnosis and Western Esotericism is kind of follows along the lines of Goodrich Clark's book here. That is to say, it's looking at esotericism, which includes mystical elements to it, from ancient Greek and Roman times on through the present. And it's a two-volume massive set, and it's got every strange esoteric movement you can think of in there, with lots of detail and lots of academic bibliography. So it's the prime source for dealing with any Western European type phenomenon. Okay? So you mentioned you're interested in the Rosicrucians. There's several big articles and articles about individual Rosicrucians and lots of stuff about them in there, right? And then it lists bibliographies about all their, some of their primary sources, like the alchemical wedding of Christian Rosenkreutz and stuff like that. Okay? So this is good for your general esotericism of Western Europe. This is the Oxford Classical Dictionary. It contains an article about every major book, person, event, idea in the classical world, Greek and Roman. Now, I have, for example, the third edition. The fourth edition has come out and costs like $150, and I hate these guys because they keep coming with new editions. So I may be citing the third edition just because I'm lazy. But all you got to do is, you know, if I put in Plotinus and I say OCD such and such has an article on Plotinus, and you want to study Plotinus more, you may go to the fourth edition rather than the third, but and it may, the page number may be different, but go to the fourth. But you know, you see what I'm saying? You may have to update that a bit. Now, for Judaism, we are not really dealing with the Bible per se, but of interpretations of the Bible by later mystical movements. And there is mysticism and esotericism in the Bible, but it's more difficult to interpret, and it's radically understood radically differently by different theological groups as well as different academic groups. But basically, what we've got here is Erdmann's Dictionary of Early Judaism covers basically what's called the Second Temple period on up into, say, 3rd century AD. So maybe 4th century BC to 3rd century AD. And it has an article on every Jewish text from that period, including lots of mystical ones, like 1st Enoch is in there. Lots of esoteric stuff in there. This one covers all of Jewish religion. It will have some articles on Kabbalists and different Jewish mystics and stuff. These two are very academic and have good bibliographies in them. This one is more general, but it has every major Kabbalist. Kabbalah is it means tradition, and it is a term used for Jewish mysticism. So I'll often say Kabbalah, and we will define the nuances of Kabbalah later, but just be aware, when I say Kabbalah, I'm talking about Jewish mysticism. When I say Sufism, I'm talking about Islamic mysticism. So I won't always say Islamic mysticism, Jewish mysticism. And then these are the major sources for Christianity. This is very general, covering all forms of Christianity. We'll have just kind of vague articles. This has something on everything to do with ancient Christianity up through maybe 600 AD. And this one is about, it says spirituality, but it's really a dictionary of mysticism. And it covers from the origins of Christianity up till the present, or at least very recently, and includes all sorts of Protestant mystics and you know, anything related to Christianity that is mystical. Then in Islam, you've got these books. There's the Encyclopedia of Islam, which is, it's got three different editions. First one ended in 36, then the second one ended in, 10 years ago they completed it. Now they've started a third edition, and it's online, some of it, but it's limited access, and you know, but anything to do with Islam, this will be a great source of information for any Islamic mystic or any form of Sufism. The first edition, all of the religious articles of the first edition were combined together by Gibb into the Shorter Encyclopedia of Islam, which is just about religion. But this was published in that form in 97, but it really is based on scholarship of the 30s. So there's been a whole bunch of new studies done since then. Glacé's book is the simplest one to get to, but it doesn't have good bibliographic references in it. But it's a good source about anything to do with Islamic religion, including all the major mystics and mystical movements and so forth. And then Ernst is just about Sufism. And he's a great scholar of Sufism, and it's a good guide to the basics of Sufism. So those are some reference books that you should take a look at, both for your own interest and on your paper. Large part of the reason I put this up there is so that you can start digging through and finding materials for your paper. Okay? Now, this is up on the blog, right? Go, one of those little links in there says reference materials, and go there and you've got that information. Now, does anybody have questions about any of that? All right, the last thing on here is bibliography on esotericism, which is basically about
the idea of secrecy in religion, that there are secrets called mysteries often in scriptural terms. And these secrets are salvific. That is, if you know the secret, it will save you. And these secrets are the essence of religion. The external forms are less important than the inner secret things.
this idea has been studied both as a phenomenon in the ancient Near East, which some of these articles are about, like secrecy in the gods is all about the idea of divine secrets in Mesopotamian and Israelite religion. It's called Sod, secret or mystery in Hebrew. This book is also about classical and Near Eastern. Here's a good general background on all sorts of bibliography and so on. So some of these are kind of more general, and some of them are specific to the ancient Near East. But the idea of secret lore, secret teachings, secret rituals, all that stuff is found in these books. So these are more about esotericism than mysticism. Okay? Now, that's the reference bibliography that's up there. And I will be posting more bibliographies on the blog as time progresses, you know, give you some more reference works. But all of these books that we've got for the class have good bibliographies and notes too. So, you know, you can find other material in there. Any questions about any of this stuff? So we've got 5 minutes left in the class. Okay, let me speak about the relationship of mysticism and esotericism. So basically, we're done with administrative questions. Unless you have some, we're going to now start getting into the substance of the course. So I'm sorry to bore you with all this stuff about administration, but some of you care about your grades, I know. Some of you don't. Some of you are just sitting here and don't have to worry about grades, which is a glorious state to achieve. I've drawn a Venn diagram here, black and orange. Black is mysticism, orange is esotericism. So just to note the relationship, mysticism is one set of ideas, esotericism another, and they overlap, but they are not the same, right? You can have mystical phenomena that are not esoteric, that is, they're not secret. Esoteric means more or less hidden, secret, inner. And you can have esoteric phenomenon that's not really mystical. Okay? Now, we're going to be focusing on the intersection, but we will be dealing, you know, with both sides of it. All right? So just bear that in mind, the relationship between the two. Mysticism is often esoteric, but not necessarily. And it's interesting to note that when we try to approach a mystic, we can only do that if they wrote something down about themselves. For most mystics, their own experience was the end in itself, and there was no point in writing it down. They had achieved what they wanted when they experienced the presence of God, and there's no reason to write it down. In fact, it can't be described, so there's no point in writing it down. Like Lao Tzu says, famous Chinese mystic, the Tao that can be spoken is not the true Tao. Tao meaning the force, the mystical power of God, something like that. If you can describe it, it's not it. And that's something about esotericism and mysticism is it can't be described, it has to be experienced. It's like love. You can talk about love all day, but it's not being in love, right? Okay, so just conceptually, even though we haven't clearly defined these terms yet, conceptually, you see how they're related and distinct. Everybody got that idea? So let us turn now to, we've only got 2 minutes. I won't start this. We'll start the what is mysticism slides next time. And these are up on the blog. Sometimes I just have like notes that are in a PDF format. Everybody can do PDF, right? Okay. The notes are in a PDF format, and I've taken on the Mac it's Keynote, but it's like PowerPoint. I took my Keynote slides and turned them into PDFs with four slides per page. And so you can get everything I do on Keynote will be a PDF form of that, as well as just plain straight text stuff. So all those notes will be up there for you. This is up there now. You can grab it. When we come back on Friday, we will get into this issue of defining mysticism and esotericism, trying to understand what scholars mean by that. And then we'll go from there, start digging into the actual movements and beliefs as opposed to abstractions. Okay? Any last questions or comments? All right. We will see you then on Friday, and we'll go from there.
I'm taking my capstone with Dr. Bowen, and I can write a paper on anything having to do with Iraq. Would I be able to do like the same kind of paper or topic for this class and that class?
Just 1 second. Let me turn this off, and then I'll get to you.
Sure.
Unfortunately, my... I don't know. There. No, where is it? Dang it. I'm having trouble with this. There we go. Okay, sorry.